just tell the story of Joseph. I want to talk about Joseph. I want to talk about some specific things about Joseph and about how we can learn to do what we're doing by the Spirit. And what do we know that Joseph knew and understood? So in chapter 37, verse 1, Jacob dwelt in the land wherein his father was a stranger, in the land of Canaan. These are the generations of Jacob. Joseph, 17 years old, was feeding the flock with his brethren. And the lad was with the sons of Bilhah and with the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives. And Joseph brought unto his father their evil report. So when we start looking at the character of Joseph here, we're just jumping right into his life. There's a lot of things about him that we may know, but I will tell you one thing for certain that's not necessarily written, but I know it's true. He was brought up knowing who he was in his father's house. He knew who he was. He wasn't confused about who his father was. He wasn't confused about his position in that. And he wasn't confused about what his father had taught them. Because the reason he went to his father and brought an evil report, I'm sure, is because this is what he'd been taught of his father to do. And when it says he brought an evil report, what is he saying? He came and told him, this is what your sons have been doing. He didn't lie. He didn't do it for him, his own, you know, puffing up of himself or to gain their position. He was already his father's son. His issue, if there was an issue, was that he was the firstborn son of the favored wife, and therefore he was the favored son, and therefore the others were jealous. We all kind of know that that's the milieu in which things are operating. But what I want you to see out of this is that he brought this report because that's what he was taught to do. He was 17 years old at this point. He had been trained in his father's house what was right and what was wrong. We don't know what they did. It doesn't really matter. So why is it in here? It's to illustrate the fact, one of the reasons why they were jealous of him? Because he did what was right and he reported on what was wrong. And that he served his father the way his father told him to. And he knew who he was. So now, verse 3, Israel, which is another name for Jacob, loved Joseph more than all his children because he was the son of his old age, and he made him a coat of colors. I mean, you'll hear a lot of people expound on what the coat was. It's not really that important. What's important is this is what his father gave him. This was something that his father gave him that was a blessing to him that marked him as really being an honored son in the house. Now, does any of this sound familiar? What I want you to begin to think about as we talk about this story is you have been brought into the house and family of God. You know who your father is. What you struggle with, or many people struggle with, is what does that mean for me? And how much access do I have? So we hear the word preached all the time that your father is a loving father. He loves you. He didn't choose you because you were special. He didn't choose you because you earned it. He didn't choose you because you obtained it. He didn't choose you because he thought you were prettier than everybody else or stronger than everybody else or smarter than everybody else. He chose you because he loved you, because he made you. And though you were lost and dead and trespassed in sin, he called us out. And when we call upon the name of the Lord Jesus, we are made his brethren. We are made like unto him. We receive his life and we have the sonship that we can say, God is my father. And our father loves us like this. And he gives us things and shows us that he honors us with these things. What are some of the things that he gives us? Very simple. He gives us the ability to call upon his name and he will answer. He gives us the ability to give thanks. He gives us the ability to praise. He gives us the ability to rejoice in him. All of these things are gifts of the Father. We don't think of them that way sometimes, but they're gifts. And they're very powerful gifts. They're gifts that do more than we think they do. Just like this coat of colors set upon him in the context that's given, it's saying to the brother, this is my beloved son. I love him very much, and I've honored him with this. And he's doing what's right because he's doing what I told him to do, even though you're upset at him for it. And when his brother in verse 4 saw that their father loved him more than all his brethren, they hated him and could not speak peaceably unto him. Do you know when you stand up and begin to say you are a son of God, that you have the authority of a son of God, that you have the access of a son of God, people will do everything they can to steal that from you. They will hate you for it. They will despise you. They will tear you down. They will call you names. They will attack you in every way they possibly can, many times subtly. They will do just what they're doing here. They will hate you because you stand up and say, I'm a son of God. And so what we often do is shrink back and then we, why don't you wear the coat for a while and I'm just not going to be a son of God right now. I'm not going to stand there. I'm going to try to blend in. Blend in. Don't want to be seen, right? This is something we deal with all the time. We're going to see where we're going to go and you're going to understand. They hated him and could not speak peaceably unto him. They hated him in their heart, so they couldn't ever even be civil to the man. They treated him very badly because they hated him, literally. And he said to them, let me tell you about this dream I dreamed. What is he doing? He's excited because he's got this relationship with God that his foundation is on him hearing about his father on earth tell him about the God who loves his family and loves everybody who's of him and of the blessing that's on his seed. He hears all this. He's going, yes, I want that. I'll take that. I'm so happy about it. And he dreams a dream. So he's excited to tell them because he's just so excited about it. Behold, we were binding sheaves in the field, and lo, my sheaf arose and stood upright, and your sheaves stood round about and made obeisance, or they bowed down to my sheaf. Isn't that great? And his brethren said to him, shall you indeed reign over us? Or shall you indeed have dominion over us? And they hated him yet the more for his dreams and for his words. The hatred just grew. They hated him. What is he doing now? Let's go back to thinking about him. He knows who his father is. And he knows the blessing of God upon his father and upon his grandfather and upon his great-grandfather. Because when his father's telling him the stories about everything that went on with Abraham and everything that went on with Isaac and everything that went on with himself, he's telling him stories. Joseph's going, I want that. I'm hungry for that. And we might think, oh, it was easy for him. He was the oldest son of the favored wife. You know, that's not what this is about. The reason it goes the way it goes is telling you that he went and gave the report to his father what's going on. He recognized what was right and what was wrong. He recognized what needs to be going on. He's being obedient to his father. It's clear that that's what's happening. But they begin to hate him. And then he gets a dream. Did he come up with a dream on his own? No, he didn't. He had this dream. Verse 9, he dreamed yet another dream and he told it to his brethren. You'd think he would have just learned to shut up and blend in. But he couldn't. Why? Because he just loved his father. And he loved his God. And he loved everything that God was showing him. He was so excited because he's having spiritual experiences. He's just excited about it. And he wants to tell them, I've dreamed a dream more, and behold, the sun and the moon and the 11 stars bowed to me. Isn't that amazing? Who's the sun and the moon? And he told it to his father and to his brethren. And his father rebuked him. And said unto him, what is this dream that thou hast dreamed? Shall I and thy mother and thy brethren indeed come to bow down ourselves to thee, to the earth? Is this really going to happen? And his brethren envied him. But his father, being a little wiser, observed the saying. He began to go, I know my God. And I know what he does, and I know the obedient son. And he didn't despise his son for it. He just was wondering about it. He was observing the saying. Maybe he should have taken a clue and prevented what happened subsequently, but who knows? God had a purpose. And his brethren went to feed their father's flock in Shechem. And Israel said to Joseph, "Do not thy brethren feed the flock in Shechem? Come, I will send thee to them." And he said, "Here I am." Once again, testifying up. I'm an obedient son. He says, "I'm sending you. Here I am. What would you like me to do, basically?" And he said unto him, "Go, I pray thee, see whether it be well with thy brethren and well with the flocks, and bring me word again." So he sent him out of the vale of Hebron, and he came to Shechem. And a certain man found him, and behold, he was wandering in the field. And the man asked him, saying, "What do you seek? What's going on?" And he said, "I seek my brethren. Tell me, I pray thee, where they feed their flocks." And the man said, "They are departed hence, for I heard them say, 'Let us go to Dothan.'" And Joseph went after his brethren and found them in Dothan. And even they saw him afar off, even before he came near unto them, they conspired against him to kill him. Because they hated him. They hated him. You ever been hated like that? I don't know that I've ever really been hated like that. I don't know that anybody has ever conspired together, especially family members, to kill me. I don't think that ever happened. You know, I always joke that my brother who was born right after me was mad at me for being first from the day he was born when he was a little guy and used to get upset at me. But I don't think he ever hated me like he would do this. This is pretty intense. Pretty intense hatred here. Why was there such an intense hatred? Because, I mean, there had been lots of stories like this and people didn't hate this much. But why was there such an intense hatred? Purposes of God. But you know what they hated? He had a relationship with God and he had the blessing of God that was being manifested and they didn't have it. Men hate that. They hate that very, very much. And they said one to another, "Behold, this dreamer comes. Come now, therefore, let us slay him, cast him into some pit, and we will say, some evil beast has devoured him, and we shall see what shall become of his dreams." And Reuben heard it, as the oldest son. And he delivered him out of their hands and said, "Let us not kill him." He knew it was wrong. And Reuben said unto them, "Shed no blood. Put him into the pit that's in the wilderness and lay no hand upon him that he might rid him out of their hands to deliver them to his father again." Reuben didn't have enough confidence that he could overtake all the brethren, but he felt like he could kind of deceptively put him in the pit and then I'll sneak around and get him out of the pit and take him home to his dad where he's safe. So Reuben's got a plan, but ultimately it doesn't work out. And it came to pass when Joseph was come unto his brethren, they stripped him out of his coat of colors that was on him. And they took him and cast him into a pit. And the pit was empty. There was no water in it. And they sat down to eat bread and lifted up their eyes and looked. And behold, a company of Ishmaelites came from Gilead with their camels, bearing spicery and balm and myrrh, going to carry it down to Egypt. And Judah said unto his brethren, "What profit is it if we slay our brother and conceal his blood? Come, let us sell him to the Ishmaelites, and let not our hand be upon him, for he is our brother and our flesh, and his brethren were content." So Judah comes up with a different plan. Let's just sell him. That'll work. Then there passed by Midianites and merchantmen, and they drew and lifted up Joseph out of the pit and sold him to the Ishmaelites for 20 pieces of silver. And they brought Joseph into Egypt. And Reuben returned unto the pit, and behold, Joseph was not in the pit, and he rent his clothes. And he returned unto his brother and said, "The child is not, and I, whither shall I go?" And they took Joseph's coat, killed a kid of the goats, and dipped the coat in the blood. And they sent the coat of many colors, and they brought it to their father and said, "This have we found. Know now whether it be thy son's coat or not." And he knew it and said, "It is my son's coat, and evil beast has devoured him. Joseph is without doubt rent in pieces." So where's the faith in that? We can see all kinds of things in that. It's like he believed it. He spoke it out of his own mouth. And, you know, he wasn't doing what he was supposed to do. Should have sought the Lord. you would think. Verse 34, and Jacob rent his clothes and put sackcloth upon his loins and mourned for his son many days. And all his sons and all his daughters rose up to comfort him, but he refused to be comforted. And he said, I will go down into the grave unto my son mourning. Thus his father wept for him. In other words, I'm going to weep until the day I die. That's what he's saying. And the Midianites sold him unto Egypt, unto Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh's and captain of the guard. Okay, and then you have to skip chapter 38. We don't need to talk about that. We want to go to 39, but let me set up 39 for you. So here's the situation. You got Joseph. We know what we know of him. When he's 17 years old, he's been brought up in his father's house, and he's an obedient son. We have evidence that he's an obedient son. And he knows the difference between what his father taught him was right and what his father taught him was wrong. We also know that he has a relationship with God whereby he's dreaming. And we know, because we know the end of the story, we know that his dreams were absolutely, positively true. He didn't make them up. They were dreams that God gave him. And he had them. But they hated him. They hated him because he was the favorite son. But really, they hated him because he was willing to be obedient and do what was right, and they were not. That's always why men hate other people. They hate them because their deeds are evil. They hate them because they love darkness rather than light. They hate them because they're envious. They give themselves to envy. And they begin to look at somebody, at what somebody else has, and they want it. And they're willing to do anything to get it from them. They don't care about how they treat the other people, person, whatever it might be. But those things, just they're not named among God's people. So these guys were not acting like God's people. They're supposed to be the people of God, but they're not acting like it. Their envy has just overtaken them so much that they hated him to the point that they make a plan to kill him. It's intense that this happens. So this is the situation. Yet Joseph is going to show us something about his character. And the whole point of talking about this is to emphasize for you that this character was built in him, not by accident, was built in him on purpose. For 17 years, he was raised in his father's house, and he was trained what was right and what was wrong and who God was to them. He did not yet have his own relationship with God, you know, when he was first a child. But at some point, he seems to have developed his own relationship with the God of his fathers. You can remember, if you look back and you remember the stories, Abraham had a relationship with God. And then Isaac carried on that relationship, and God came to Isaac and said, the same blessings on Abraham I'm giving to you. And the same thing for Jacob. He gave the same blessings to Jacob, right? We don't hear that for Joseph here. Later on, and we're not going to get there, but later on, there are scriptures that tell us that there's a birthright, the rights of the firstborn that Joseph received, but the blessing that your seed shall bless the whole earth, that blessing fell upon Judah, because it was evident that our Lord sprang out of Judah, right? That's where Jesus came from. So there was a split between the blessing and the birthright. This is why you don't quite hear the same thing. But the birthright was Joseph's. There's a scripture that says that outright. The birthright was Joseph's. He received it. It was given unto him, and then it was given unto his sons. And which son got the birthright? Ephraim, who was the second born. Manasseh was the firstborn. He didn't get it. It was Ephraim who got the birthright of the firstborn was actually passed to Ephraim. Ephraim became one of the greatest tribes. Which tribe did it strive with over ruling over Israel? Judah. If you look at the two kingdoms, is Israel and Judah, as we call them, is basically Ephraim was the dominant tribe in the northern kingdom, Judah was the dominant tribe in the southern kingdom. So I've digressed quite a bit, but let's understand that at this point, Joseph has a relationship with God that's based upon, what do we know it's based upon? What his father has taught him, honoring his father and his father's wishes, in the first verse that we read, and secondarily being so quick to respond in obedience when his father called him. These are illustrative of who Joseph was. So now, Joseph has been sold as a slave to Egypt. So this is where he gets depressed and unhappy and upset and frustrated and angry at his brothers and begins to plot how he's going to get his revenge. Or at least that's how most movies would write the story, right? This is what we would do. That's not Joseph. Joseph knows something absolutely perfectly. He knows who his father is, and he knows who his God is. And so he's now in Potiphar's house, and what happens to him? Verse 31 of 39, and Joseph was brought down to Egypt, and Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh, captain of the guard, an Egyptian, bought him of the hands of the Ishmaelites, which had brought him down thither. And the Lord was with Joseph, and he was a prosperous man, and was in the house of his master the Egyptian. And his master saw the Lord was with him, and the Lord made all that he did to prosper in his hand. What did Joseph do? He gave himself what was set at his hand to do. You know, it's a lot easier when you're a slave, like he was, because you really don't get your own opinion. If they tell you to carry the stuff and put it over there, that's what you do. And there's no, well, you know, I think there's a better way. I think I'm going to invent a dump truck so that I can, you know, do it. We all have our ideas. We live in America where it's every man is a king in his own castle, right? And Lord over his own thing. And we think that way. But Joseph sitting here, he's a slave. That means he doesn't get to decide, I think I'd like to go in the ministry. I think I should be actually an itinerant preacher and I need to be stepping out. He was locked in because he was owned by Potiphar, right? But what does he do? He becomes the absolute best slave he could possibly be. In fact, he's a prosperous man. And the master notices something. The Lord was with him. The master notices this. The Lord's with Joseph. Now, does that mean that Joseph was preaching the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob and telling them all about it? Or is he just noticing that he was such a prosperous man? And really the reason Joseph was prosperous is because the Lord was with him. And he notices this. And that the Lord made all that he did to prosper in his hand. For many of us, we're constantly thinking about something that's on the horizon instead of looking at what we're doing right now. What we're doing is what's set at our hand to do. And everything that we do, we're supposed to do it is unto the Lord. So if what's set at your hand to do right now is to be a student, be the best student unto the Lord you can be. If what's set at your hand to do is working a job, be the best whatever you are that you can possibly be. If you're a father, be the best father you can be. If you're a son or a daughter, be the best you can be. If you're a mother, be the best you can be in the Lord. Do that, because this is what Joseph did. And notice, we're going to see in the end, Joseph gets abundantly blessed. Right? We want to be abundantly blessed. And sometimes we lose sight of what we're doing for all of our thoughts about what we might be doing. It's very easy to do. But Joseph knew who his God was. He wasn't confused and wondering and trying to decide if he was saved. He wasn't confused and wondering and deciding if his father would use him. He knew the purposes of God. He knew the plan of God. He knew who he was. And therefore, he acted like it. And he set his hand to be prosperous for his master. And he found grace, verse 4, in his sight. And he served him. And he made him overseer over his house. And all that he had, he put into his hand. I mean, he was so good that Potiphar just said, you got it all, man. Just take care of it all. You're this best investment I ever made. It's buying you. It came to pass from the time that he had made him oversee in his house and over all that he had, the Lord blessed the Egyptian's house for Joseph's sake. And the blessing of the Lord was upon all that he had in the house and in the field. I mean, I remember reading this and I had this experience when I first took over as the head of my medical group way, way, way back. And I met with the CEO for the first time and I said, listen, I want you to understand something. I may not always know what I'm doing. I may not know what the right thing to do in everybody's estimation is, but here's one thing I do know, that if I am here, this place will be blessed because I am here. She just looks at me. I said, no, I'm telling you. I know that everything looks bleak right now. The finances are terrible. Everything looks hard, but I guarantee you, we will be blessed because I am here. not because of anything I'm going to do perfect and because I'm better than anybody else at the job, because my Father is going to bless us because I am here. And that's exactly what happened. You know, when you stand up and testify who God is, He will confirm the truth of it. When you hold back and try to hide behind and filter in, it doesn't work so good. It's boldness is required. And then what will happen is that sometimes you won't do it that way. And then you get upset at yourself. No, just go back to who you know who your Father is. You know who your Father is, and He's a forgiving and loving Father. He'll even forgive iniquity. He'll forgive. All you have to do is ask. So this is Joseph, right? And you know the rest of it. I'm not going to read it all. You know the basic story. What happens? There comes an assignment of the enemy to try to destroy Joseph, and ends up lying about who he is, and suddenly Potiphar's got to choose before the best slave he's ever gotten, his own wife. Well, he picked the wife story. I always wonder, he probably knew his wife was lying. I don't, you know, who knows? But the long and the short of it is, Joseph gets, now he goes from being a slave and the master of all of this high-ranking Egyptian's house. So he was living a pretty good life as a slave. It was okay. But what's going on? Now he's in prison. Prison isn't just slavery. Prison's like worse. Okay? It's terrible. You don't even, you can get to decide anything. They lock you up. They put you in shackles. I mean, it's an ugly mess. Right? You get thrown into prison. And so, verse 20 says, Joseph's master took him and put him into the prison, a place where the king's prisoners were bound. So maybe it was a little nicer prison than some. I don't know. Not by our estimations. And he was there in the prison. But notice verse 21. But the Lord was with Joseph and showed him mercy and gave him favor in the sight of the keeper of the prison. We get no evidence that Joseph ever despaired. We get no evidence that he ever worried about any of this. How long was this? I mean, how long does it take to go from, I just bought this slave and now I'm giving him rulership over everything in my house? That doesn't happen in a week. It happens over years. It takes time to develop that kind. Oh, this guy can do, oh, he can do that too. And, oh, and he can do that. Oh, and he's good at this too. And he's honest. And oh, and you test him and you watch what he does. And he sees it. So he gives him more authority. And then he does well with that. And, you know, it took a long time. He built himself up to being the overseer of the entire house. Now he's bound in prison. All that work for nothing. He got nothing at the end of it. All he got was prison. Because some woman lied about him. Now he's in prison, and the same thing, the Lord blesses him. He's not focused on where he is, he's focused on who his Father is. That's what's going on here. He knows who his Father is. And he said, that says here, the Lord was with him and showed him mercy and gave him favor in the sight of the keeper of the prison. How long did that take? It didn't happen in a week. It took time. But he got favor. And the keeper of the prison committed to Joseph's hand all the prisoners that were in the prison. And whatsoever they did there, he was the doer of it. He was the organizer. He managed it all. Just like he did for Potiphar, the keeper of the prison just pretty much turned the prison over to the prisoner. You know, you're doing a better job than I am. Because the Lord was with him. He knew who his Father was. He wasn't afraid to be the best prisoner he could possibly be, because that was what was before him. It's what he was doing. The keeper of the prison looked in verse 23, not to anything that was under his hand, because the Lord was with him, and that which he did, the Lord made it to prosper. He didn't have to worry about any of it. And so it came to pass, and I'm not going to read all of this stuff. You know the story. I know all of you here know the story. You can, everybody else that's watching can read it. In chapter 40, and it's the dreams that the butler and the baker had, and they come down into the prison. They're thrown into the king's prison along with Joseph, and Joseph is the keeper, so he gets to know all the prisoners coming in and going out, knows who everybody is. They have some dreams. Joseph says, let's read what he says. And then verse 8, they said unto him, we have dreamed a dream, and there's no interpreter of it. And Joseph said unto him, do not interpretations belong to God? Tell me them, I pray you. Notice what he says. They belong to God. Tell them to me. What does he know? He knows who his God is. He knows his Father. He has a relationship with God. It's based upon what he's been told by his Father about who he is, about the birthright that he has, about who the God of his fathers is, and that all the seed of his father can be blessed. He's one of them, so I'm blessed. You know, his other brothers could have done the same. They could have accepted the exact same thing, but they didn't. They didn't. So verse 8, he says they belong to God. So they tell him their dreams, their interesting dreams, and he gives them the interpretation, and everything that he said comes to pass. And he tells the butler, who he says, you're going to be released. Baker, you're going to get killed. Sorry. Butler, you're going to be released. When you go before the king, please remember me to the king. You know, please. He makes his first attempt at, like, you know, I'd like to get out of prison. Could you please? Here's a great opportunity. Could you remember me to the king? So what promptly happens is the butler forgets all about it. He's just so excited that he got pulled out of prison that he just forgets the whole thing. And suddenly, you know, Joseph's still in the prison being what? A model prisoner who knows who his God is. He knows. Right? And it came to pass at the end of 2 full years. So now it's 2 more years. It's however many years it was that he built up in Potiphar's house, then got cast in prison, then he built up in the prison, and now he interprets the dream, and it's 2 years since then. Okay, so he's got 2 years going, well, I guess, you know, I'm despairing. God has forgotten me and forsaken me. No, he was doing what was at his hand to do. And behold, Pharaoh dreamed a dream, and he stood by the river, and there came out of the river 7 well-favored kine and fat-fleshed and fed in a meadow. And 7 other kine came up after them out of the river, ill-favored, lean-fleshed, stood by the other kine upon the brink of the river. And the ill-favored and lean-fleshed kine did eat up the 7 well-favored and fat kine. And so Pharaoh awoke. And then he dreamed another dream. And so he's having dreams, and nobody can interpret them. And his spirit was troubled, and they didn't know what to tell him. And then suddenly the butler remembers. I remember. There was this guy in prison, and he interpreted my dream. And so he tells Pharaoh the story. So Pharaoh says, call him. Pharaoh sent, verse 14, and called Joseph. And they brought him hastily out of the dungeon. And he did something interesting. He shaved himself. Why did he shave himself? Anybody know? Egyptians hate beards. They don't like them. Back in those days, they didn't wear beards, especially not royal ones. So he shaved himself. So you shave yourself off, because if you were an Israelite, you grew beards. But so he shaved himself. It's an interesting thing. He changed his clothes, and he came to Pharaoh. And Pharaoh said to Joseph, I've dreamed a dream, and he tells him about the dream. And then Pharaoh and Joseph interprets it for him. Now, it's an interesting thing, because this goes rather quickly. I mean, you call Joseph out of prison, and then you make him ruler, second ruler in the kingdom. I guarantee it didn't quite happen like that. But this is a condensed version, right? What happens? So, verse 32 says, the dream was doubled unto Pharaoh twice. It's because the thing is established by God, and God will shortly bring it to pass. Now, therefore, let Pharaoh look out a man discreet and wise, and set him over the land of Egypt. Let Pharaoh do this, and let him appoint officers over the land, and take up the 5th part of the land of Egypt in the 7 plenteous years, and do all these things. And verse 37, the thing was good in the eyes of Pharaoh and in the eyes of all his servants. And Pharaoh said unto his servants, can we find such a one as this, a man in whom is the Spirit of God? And Pharaoh said unto Joseph, for as much as God has showed thee all this, there is none so discreet and wise as you are. I'll guarantee you that Pharaoh looked into Joseph's life, and he inquired about who this guy was before he was brought before him. I'll guarantee he looked into it. And he had heard probably Potiphar's story. Who is this guy? How did he end up in prison? Because that's what I would ask. If I'm the king, and they tell me there's this guy in prison, and interprets, why is he in prison? I mean, did he like assassinate somebody? I mean, what's the story here? You'd ask the question. I'm sure he answered all those questions. It didn't just happen as a miracle, but the key thing was is because God gave him favor. And he saw in Joseph, he saw something. He saw his relationship with God. And God gave Joseph favor, and he became the ruler. And we know how the rest of it ended. We know that the sons came and bowed themselves before Joseph, just like he saw in his dream. And we know that Jacob and his wives had to come and bow themselves before Joseph, just like he saw in his dream. It's an amazing, amazing story. What's the point? Joseph knew his God. He knew him. He knew who he was, and he had a relationship with him that was built on the word of God. What word of God, you ask? The word that was given to Abraham and to Isaac and to Jacob and had been taught to him. Because he was taught as a young man, this is right, this is wrong, this is how you behave, this is who your God is, this is how you put your trust in him. No matter what you see, no matter what happens, there's famine in the land your grandfather Isaac sowed. You know, I was going to be killed by my brother, and yet God told me to go back, and so I came back and God delivered me out of the hand of my brother. You know, all the stories and all the rest of the chapters that talk about those things. And there's so much more to say, because remember, this is an extremely condensed version. There's so much to say. But in all of it, what you get out of Joseph is that he was obedient to his God and he honored his God. There's a very similar story when we talk about the book of Daniel. When Daniel and his friends were taken captive by the Babylonians, they were the top Hebrew university students. They were the young men who were the head of everything. They were the bright, shining stars of the court that were going to be up and coming, you know, people who worked in the government and made everything run well, and the courtiers of the king. And these were these very young men, and on their way to becoming that, because they've been selected for being so perfect. Those are the ones that Babylon carried away captive in the first captivity. Subsequently, they just took everybody, except the poorest people who they left behind. But they took the best and the brightest, right? These were men, young men, who had been raised to do what was right in the order of the Jewish law. They've been raised that way. They didn't just burst on the scene out of nowhere. They had been raised to be diligent servants and diligent men of honor and integrity. They've been raised that way. And they knew the law of God. They knew the word of God. They knew what was right and what wasn't right. And they refused to do what was wrong, and God blessed them. But they became the greatest of all the wise men in Babylon. Daniel certainly did. He became the ruler of Babylon de facto underneath Nebuchadnezzar. He subsequently, Babylon gets conquered, and he becomes the ruler of the city of Babylon under the Medo-Persian king. Which is pretty amazing. Why? Because he was excellent at what he did. He was excellent. He knew how to be a ruler in a royal house. He knew. He had learned. He had applied himself to what was set at his hand to do. When he got carried away captive to Babylon, he was told, "You need to become this. And therefore, we're going to use all of our skills to teach you how to be this." And they refused to do things that would be contrary to the law of God. People say, you know, what did they eat and all that? What, the problem was they were not going to eat meat offered to idols. That was not something that you did. They were not going to do that. So the only way to avoid that was just avoid meat altogether. It wasn't that they had a problem with meat in and of itself. It was the fact that the meat in Babylon was all offered to idols. They couldn't eat it. They said, just, we won't eat all that food with lots of calories to make you big and strong. We won't eat any of that. We're just going to eat this. Simple, basic foods, grains and vegetables and whatever. And then they applied themselves to the teaching, and they learned better than all the other Babylonians, who also were the choice people brought out, right? And brought into the situation. Why? Because they were good at competing and defeating their foes. See, that's what the others learned, because what you see them do is, well, Daniel's superseded us, we need to take him down a notch. You know, remember when it's the Medo-Persian king, they get upset because Daniel's getting favored again. They thought with the new change, maybe they'd get a chance to be number one. And yet they recognize right away, God's with Daniel. You could see it all over him. So they gave the job to Daniel and they get jealous. So then they said, let's sneak around behind Daniel's back. Let's get the king to make a law that if you bow down to anybody but the king for this period of time, that you get thrown in a den of lions. And what does Daniel do? He gives praise unto his God out of his relationship that he had with God. Because he was never about defeating his colleagues. He was never about promoting himself. He was about doing the best he could of what was set at his hand to do. So when he went to work at wherever you work and you whatever your job description is, he applied himself to being the best he could be. And he did it diligently. And if they threw him into prison for it, he became the best prisoner, as Joseph did. Well, Daniel did the same. It's another example of that. It's one of the important things that we have to learn, especially with young people talking about coming up, things that I wish I'd known when I was 16, 17, 18. I wish when I was 17 years old, like Joseph, that I had been trained in all of the things of God such that I understood who my father was, to where it could never be taken away from me. I could not doubt it. I could not be wondering, is God my father or is he upset with me today? You know, those struggles that we often go through, or people often go through, because they don't know who their God is. They're not established in understanding that God is their father and they are his sons and his daughters. And he loves them and he corrects them out of love. And he brings us to that place that he wants us to be. And all he asks of us is that we trust in him. So if you trust him and you get thrown in prison for something you didn't do, you're not going to be upset. You're not going to look for revenge. You're not going to be angry. You're not going to be, you know, destroying everything around you and destroying yourself with bitterness of soul. You're going to rejoice. You're going to give thanks because God gave you those tools to keep you no matter what's going on. That I don't care how bad today, this hour, this week, this year, this lifetime feels, I can rejoice in him always. I can give thanks in all things. I can praise him because he's worthy to be praised. As Job said, when his kids are dead, his wife leaves him, his stuff's cast down, all his cattle are gone, he's got boils over his body, I will yet praise my God. He had a tool left. I'm going to praise my God. My testimony looks a little ugly right now, but I'm going to praise God because I know who my God is. That's Joseph. That's Daniel. And we need to operate in this same way. However old you are, whatever you've been through, whatever's going on, we are going to know. And if you don't know, find out quickly. If somebody needs to get saved, call upon the name of the Lord right now. He'll save you. And he'll make you a son. He gives us power to be his children, his sons, because we are one with Jesus. The Son has given us his life and made us joint heirs with him in his family. We are now can look at God and say, he is my father. When you know who your God is, there's no despair. There's no fear. There's no worry. There's none of those things. And if you feel those things coming, you turn back to what you know. I'm sure that Joseph had a few moments, especially when he gets accused unjustly and gets thrown into prison. Look, my brothers hated me. They sold me. I got here. I was working my way up. And then I get thrown into prison. It's like, this is just unfair. Nothing works out for me. Would have been a common theme. But he apparently didn't go there. And if he went there at all, it was a very short time. Because he would turn. And out of his relationship with God, he would begin to honor him. He would begin to praise him. He would begin to thank him for all that he'd done. He'd been to rehearse to himself the promises to his great-grandfather Abraham, rehearse the promises to his grandfather Isaac, rehearsed the promises to his father Jacob, rehearsed the promises to him, and he would just believe his God for years. Not months, not weeks, years. Years of steady doing, trusting as God, until the day when he was raised up to fulfill the purposes that God had for him. It was this particular day. He couldn't become second ruler in the kingdom when he was 17. There's just no way for that to happen. All he knew was God had given him a dream and showed him, I have a purpose for your life, Joseph. And on that, two dreams, as far as we know, and out of his relationship with God, on those two dreams, he lived the rest of his life honoring God and thanking him for what eventually happened. It's astounding. So what do we do in our own life? I pray as we move into, you know, the next season of what we're doing, that we're going to be raising up kids here that know their God. And all of us that are past that stage need to be imparting to the kids, your God loves you. Your God saved you. Your God called you. And rehearsing everything that Jesus did, rehearsing everything the Father said to them, everything that's been given by the Holy Ghost to teach them, teaching them how to honor the house of God, teaching them how to honor the gifts that he gave them, gifts to be able to rejoice, gifts to give thanks. I was never taught that these were gifts to me. I took them as burdens to be borne. I got to give thanks again. You know, it was never quite that bad, but you understand what I'm saying. It's like you hear give thanks and you go, I got to give thanks. It's so hard. My body hurts. My brain hurts. Everything hurts. I got to give thanks. I'll give thanks. And maybe God will accept me if I give thanks. No. Thanksgiving is a gift he gave me. So that I know that in whatever's going on, I can begin to go, oh, thank you, Father. I know that you're my Redeemer. I know that you're my Waymaker. I know that you're my God. I know that you've saved me. I know that you've called me. I know that you have purposes for me. Father, here I am. I don't even know what to do, but Lord, I give thanks unto you. It's a gift, not a burden to be borne. Oh, I'm failing to give thanks. I'm a bad guy. No, just remember the gift. Pick it up. Use it. It's yours. It's freely given. We have even greater gifts, you know. We have the gift of the Holy Ghost. You've been baptized in the Holy Ghost. You have the gift of praying in the Spirit. You have the gift of flowing in the Holy Ghost. It's been given to you. It's freely given. You didn't have to earn it. You just asked. And he gave it to you. And those gifts you get to pick up and use so that you can remind yourself who your God is. Then, even when you're in prison, you can be blessed. I'm sure that Joseph was blessed when he was the bottom prisoner, had just come in. Everybody else was trying to figure out how they could, you know, get the fresh meat to do something for them, how they could mistreat him, whatever. Who knows? Prisons are ugly places. As he got brought in there, as the bottom of the totem pole, he still praised. He still gave thanks. Because that, I'll guarantee you, was his relationship with God. Praise and thanksgiving and honor and remembering the covenant that God had made. Well, he made with us a new covenant. It's not founded on promises that required the strength of our arm to obtain. You will be blessed because you do. This covenant was founded on what Jesus did already for us. He lived a sinless life. He shed his blood. He went to hell. He rose from the dead. He did all of that, that we might be partakers with him of everything that he did, so that that covenant cannot be broken. Joseph's, the covenant he had, that God had made with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, that covenant was established and foundational and for Joseph could not be broken. God finally said that Israel had my covenant, which they break. This covenant we have, you can break it for you, but it's an eternal covenant for whosoever will. And you can be a whosoever will. Today I'll take up my covenant, my place in the covenant, and I'll give thanks, and I will worship, and I will joy, and I will flow in the Holy Ghost, and I will begin to prophesy, and I will begin to speak in heavenly languages, and I will begin to sing in the Spirit and pray in the Spirit, and all of these things that I'm going to do. What am I doing those for? Because they're gifts given to me that he honored me with. And just like Joseph wore his coat and didn't hide it, there were gifts that God, his father, had given him. He wore it. It's my coat. Father gave it to me. He wasn't concerned about how other people responded. He took it. Said, yes, yes, this is my God. I will not allow you to get away with doing evil. I will report it to my father. And I'm certain he didn't hate his brothers. They hated him. But what happened when they came? He loved them. You know the story, right? When they came, Joseph loved them. He tested them. He wanted to see what was in their heart. But not because he was afraid. Not because he hated them. Because he loved them. And he brought them all in and said, don't you worry. And then when their father died, they all thought that Joseph was going to kill him. Now he's going to kill us. They still had the vestiges left over, this kind of attitude. Joseph, no. Don't be upset. The father sent me to make a way for you. So I could, yeah, I had to bear the burden of being a slave and going to prison. But you know, God did it so I could eventually be the second rule in the kingdom and I could bless you and care for you in time of need. Isn't that amazing? That's what he told them. It's just, he knew his God. If you take nothing away from that, he knew his God. And he knew that his God loved him. And he knew his God never failed. And he honored him in everything he did. And because he honored God, God blessed him. And everybody who was around him got blessed too. So in light of that, as we move forward this next year, we're going to be working on some of these school things that we're going to be doing some more of. This is what we want to impart to the children more than anything else. To know who their God is. You're not limited by who your earthly parents were. You're not limited by your education level even. You're not limited by how big or how fast or how strong or how beautiful you are. You're not. There are no limitations for what God will do with you. But you need to take up the gifts that he's given you and live in them and then be diligent about whatever's set at your hand to do. If it's set at your hand to play the piano, give yourself diligently to the piano. If it's set at your hand to minister to the kids in any capacity, do it with all your heart. If you have a job that God is pleased for you to go to, go and be the best that you could possibly be. Be better than everybody else, not out of competition, because you're doing it under the Father. Saying, Lord, you're deserving of the best. I'm going to do the best. Because we got to teach kids to be excellent without entering into the strife of the academic competition system. And that's if you're mixed up with the world, it's a tough thing to do. If you're just living in the Holy Ghost, it's a blessing. But at the same time, we don't want to teach the kids to forsake being excellent. Joseph was excellent. Daniel was excellent at what they did. And I'll bet that Jesus was an amazing student at whatever place they had him. Because I'm sure he went to the Hebrew school. And I'm sure that he learned a trade with his father. And I'll bet he was excellent at it. And the best carpenter. I don't know. Some people say stonemason. Some people say carpenter. I don't even know. Doesn't matter. Whatever it was, I guarantee he's the best. Because he was diligent and he was honorable. And he did what he was told. And he applied himself. And if he had struggled with how to move this just the right way, he worked at it till he was good at it. That's what you do. You take correction happily. Oh, I need to do it a little more like this. Let me do it better. Okay, good. All right, thank you. All right, we're going to be better now. We're going to get this done. And then you do it excellently. Learning how to take correction is key. But when you know who your father is and you know how much he loves you, it's easy. We make it hard because we get, you know, like many of us, brought up in a heathen home with all kinds of crazy ideas, taught things that aren't true. And then we're 17 and we don't know right from wrong. So we've tried to raise a generation in here where there's a young people now. They're 17, 16, 18, 25, whatever. They've been raised different. Better than I was raised. And then we're going to raise the next generation even better. Because we're going to strive for excellence. We're going to do it excellently. That's what we're going to do. So I digressed a little bit there from the story of Joseph, but this is what was sparking to me, because I've been praying about this thing. It's coming down. It's the summer's coming, and we're going to, you know, what are we doing, Lord? How are we going to do this thing? How are we going to teach people to raise children in the Holy Ghost and yet excellent in everything that they do, whatever's set at their hand? Where are we going to do that? What are the things to avoid? What are the things to do? How do we empower people to do this? It's going to be a big deal. And we've been doing it here. It's been done here. It's been modeled here. You always got to model it first. And now the next step is we're going to do it even more excellently. And then we're going to perpetuate it as we go forward, right? So Joseph, go study again the story of Joseph. Read it a number of times. Look at it. Ask the Lord to inspire you with, I can be that because I have God as my Father. I can be that. It's not a call to everybody be second ruler of Egypt. Most of us will probably never go to Egypt. That's not the point. The point is to be whatever God called you to be. Be excellent at it. Amen. Father, I ask you, Lord, to penetrate deep within us, Father. Help us to learn how to stand before you in prayer and in worship and thanksgiving, knowing that these are great gifts that are given unto us by you freely because you loved us. Lord, we thank you for it. We honor you. We glorify your name. And we choose, oh God, to walk with you in the Spirit. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. And I thank you, Lord, that whoever might see this, that they would come to understand that all it takes is to call upon the name of the Lord and they'll be saved. That anybody who hears these stories and says, I want to be excellent, begins to say, Lord, you make me excellent. You teach my hands to war. You teach my fingers to fight. You teach me to do everything that's right. You teach me to stand against the darkness and to say yes to the light. You teach me, O Lord, the weapons of my warfare that are not carnal. These things that you've given unto me, the shield of faith and this breastplate of righteousness. Lord, because my heart believes unto righteousness and confession is made out of my mouth that Jesus is my Lord. He's my Lord. He's my God. He's my brother. He is my life. Everything to me. He is my Redeemer. He's my wisdom. He's my sanctification. He's everything to me. That's the confession of my mouth. And I believe unto the righteousness of Jesus has been imparted unto me that I might be a son of God. And I walk with him no matter what any man may say. No matter what people may think that they see, I'm walking with him and he's making my way perfect. He is. He's doing this for me. Amen.